Okay, so you know, like at least you know that you're being recorded when you present yourselves. I will start with myself. I'm George Dafoulas. I'm an associate professor at Middlesex University in the Faculty of Science and Technology. I'm director of programs for the Computer Science Department, and I have degrees in three different disciplines. So I have my first 4 degrees and PhD in computer science, but I also have an MBA, and also have 3 degrees in educational technology, and more specifically in higher education, my latest master's. So I have a combination of 3 areas which I'll try to combine in this session. It is Good Friday here, but my very good friend Natella asked me to do this session today. So what we'll do is, like, we're going to focus in the for the next 1 hour and 40 minutes on various aspects of creativity from a student-centered perspective. But before going into more detail, I'd really like if you would have if you would like to introduce yourselves over a couple of sentences in terms of who you are, and more importantly, why you're here today, and what would you like to make out of this session.
Okay, hello, nice to meet you. My name is Inga Tepetis. Nowadays, PhD student at International University. As for my profession, I am aviation English language specialist. And as for what I want to take from this particular lecture, I would like to get more knowledge and updates in terms of technologies using EOT. So this is my expectation.
My name is Marina Chilama. This is my first day at this university. I'm PhD candidate. I'm a teacher at the National Defense Academy Military University. So this lecture will give you lots of information about how to use technologies and some important and interesting information about it in general.
My name is Nina Mori. I'm freshman as well at Ibsu University, and I'm interested in subjects as teaching English as a second language. I'm more interested about technologies, how to use them, how to implement them, and what type of technologies are used during teaching English, and how to improve any kind of learning processes that are in the universities
right now. I'm just going to thank you. I'm a PhD student at the International Flexi University. My field is EOT, so I expect from this course to gain as much as possible in terms of meaningful use of technology in education, and especially in the EOT.
Hello, my name is Marian. I'm a PhD student.
Just if you are unaware, they are all English language teaching or ELT students.
Okay.
Their abbreviation.
Okay.
Hi there, my name is Murat. I'm the Vice Director for Research, and I'm also the Head of Strategic Planning Office. I am coming from ELT background, but I am now into in education management, higher education management. That's where I did my PhD. And I'm interested because it's technology. I mean, I started to use technology in 1983 with a Sinclair Spectrum computer with a cassette tape. You remember those times. So, you know, it's an ambition for me. So. And I also offer instructional technology or, you know, ELT or using technology in ELT classes as well. So, yeah.
Hey, that's brilliant. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and all of you to for introducing yourselves. The title of these slides, because we had an issue with Mehmet in terms of uploading a video and animation, so I cannot use animation through remotely. So the actual title that we agreed with Natella, but we didn't. When we changed the file, we did not include it there. Is facilitating student-centered creativity with technology, and also including parts of social learning networks. So what we will do today is that we're going to be focusing on a number of issues. So I will start with the boring part, and the boring part will take some time because it's talking about. Although creativity is in its own, it should not be boring, but we have to go through definitions and what people talk about when they use the term creativity. I will focus on some unorthodox practices and how I use creativity. Also, I will focus on the three areas that Natella asked me to cover, which is on the student-centered creativity with technology. So these are creative thinking in relation to authentic instruction, different types of types and characteristics of creativity, and how we facilitate creative thinking while at the same time we meet the standards for delivering content. I will include also some cases of my own creativity. I have a very strong background on educational technology, but I didn't want to have it too heavy on educational technology. So we will focus on curriculum design and development. We will talk about creative techniques, the role of feedback, how student engagement and learning enhancement can be enhanced and improved through the use of creative ways of using technology. And these five sections are like different case studies of mine. I plan for these to be a very interactive session, so I will probably ask questions. Also, Natella talked to me about 1 hour 40 minutes. If you want to have a break in between, please interrupt me so we can have a break when needed. Sorry, Natella.
No time for break because afterwards they have another meeting.
So no break. Okay. Good. So not even for me. Good.
For you, you can give them some tasks. And while they're doing the task,
breathe
out a little bit.
Okay, so creative learning. When we talk about creative learning, we have various perspectives. What I have here is like in every slide, you have the resources where you can get more information. But the emphasis on from the quality perspective of the educational system we have in England, creative learning is widely understood for us to be part of several, to have several characteristics. First of all, it has to be questioning and challenging. In other words, it has to make sure that the student, regardless of the age group, and although I teach mostly higher education, whenever I do the aspects of creativity, I focus on school children as well of different kind of age groups. So whatever we're going to cover today, we will have to be able to adapt it to cover anything from the age of 5-6 up to university level. So initially it has to be questioning and challenging. The creative mind has to think, what if something else happens? Also making connections and relationships. So we need to foster the ability of students to take something from the class and apply to their own scenarios. Envisaging what might be, we need to make people become a little bit of risk takers. What will happen if I'll change something? To get people outside of their comfort zones. Also, we need to be able to explore ideas and keep options open. In other words, creativity is all about being flexible and also reflecting and critically on ideas. It means that we have to check, we have to put everything into a test. What I have here is like a few examples of different definitions of creativity. So the Creativity Portal is a very good resource that provides Scotland creative learning plan. So what you could do is like you could go on that website there, Creativity Portal, and you can see how the Scottish parts deal with creativity. A very interesting website is also Creativity at Work, And what it does is like it identifies imagination, creativity, empathy, and innovation as the value creation in education. What do we mean by that? In order to create value for my students, first of all, I have to trigger their imagination. How will they solve problems? How they will analyze different scenarios to be able to deal with the what-if scenario. I will jump creativity because creativity is the focus of this lecture, but then we will have to consider about empathy. Not sympathy, but empathy. In other words, I have to get into the role of my students, get a little bit of role playing. So every time I get in the class, because I do a lot of flip the classroom techniques as well, I'm not going to touch on them now because Nutella has booked me for 2 sessions. So the most exciting examples, I have kept them for the second session. But when I do flip the classroom, I need to empathize with my students. How will they cover the materials that I will give them before the lecture? How will they cover technology? What are the technical difficulties they have? What is their knowledge background? What about their experience or the lack of experience that will affect their opportunity to apply the theory into practice? And of course, innovation, because innovation is critical for value creation. If we do not innovate in the way that we teach, or if we do not show the students how they can innovate themselves, then we do not teach. We just recite information that's in the book. So it's very important for us to be creative, because creativity and all the other three aspects, they create value. If we fail to create value, our students can stay at home, read the books, go on YouTube, download tutorials, and they can learn themselves. Researchers, this is one of the definitions that we will see next, which are, from a research point of view, creativity is about being unique and novel, but also relevant and useful. I will go on and on. So we have at least 3 or 4 slides talking about creativity definition. So one of the important aspects of some workers and scholars is about the role of play in creative learning. So a roundtable report was commissioned by LEGO Education. So you have to consider organizations like LEGO. Invest a lot on how creative learning can be part of education. On Tuesday, we had one of our annual conferences at Middlesex, and part of the teaching and learning key practices was how to use Lego toys in education. And there is a training session that I've done in the past where you get the Legos and have to be imaginative and create scenarios and be able to express yourselves. So this is another aspect of creativity. However, we have to consider that not everybody is the same. We have people who can be creative by drawing, people can be creative by imagining and using images and scenarios. Creativity can be role playing, but also creativity is the use of technology in a creative way. So whatever we cover today and whatever you've written about creativity, you have to consider that it is important possible to, if you like, to pigeonhole creativity and say creativity is, this is how it's defined. Creativity is a concept which is, if you like, so wide that it's difficult to constrain it, and why should we? This part of the slide shows ideas of promoting creativity in learning. Creativity is part of the learning. As I will show you later on, when I teach in my class, I make sure that the students are creative on their own. I use emotional connections. What does this mean? When I start my classes at the beginning of the year, I do profiles of every student. So I know whether they are more visual or audio, or kinesthetic or reflective. I know whether my students are introverts or extroverts. So I create a profile for each one of them. And during the year, I'm trying to touch different parts of the personality or different parts of the way that they learn or they lead the team, because then I can make an emotional connection. For example, if I have a bureaucratic mind in my class, I will try to get in touch with their idea of systems and following rules, because this is how they will be able to be emotionally attached to what I cover. If I have somebody who's completely unstructured, over-creative, and against a constructivist approach, then I will need to be creative myself. I need to trigger their interest by explaining the what-if scenarios. Creativity has to be under a positive light. It's very difficult to deal with people who come into a lecture. I've been in so many creativity workshops, and I have people who come in and say, guys, for the next half hour, we're going to be creative, and I want you to be creative, and I want you to be as creative as possible. Immediately, that becomes homework to me. You cannot just go in a scenario, in a session, and say to everyone, I want you to be creative. This is not a positive aspect of creativity, so we have to trigger it somehow. Expressive freedom. I've been in a very interesting training session in the past where a senior manager said to us, I want you to create a creative session, but I don't want you to dress up. I don't want you to use weird language. Please don't play any music. And, you know, like, just make sure that you look professional. And I pulled myself out. I said, you know, like, if you want me to be creative, you cannot restrain me in such a way. One of the things that I will show you in a minute is that how I tried to do a creativity session at the university that I work for. The problem was I could not do candles, because the plan was that I would play the music, I would have some scented candles there, and we will have low lights, and we will try to be doing breathing exercises. Immediately, the session was a failure because I could not use the candles, I could not use the music as I wanted it, and so on. So that can be a problem as well. Creativity means mistakes. In other words, I cannot be creative and I cannot create something new unless I try and I fail. And one of the best things that I do when I write a paper is that I share what I've learned, and I have a couple of my most widely accepted papers where how I shared the failures that I had in my class. And when I went to the conference, everybody was excited to hear this guy who said, I'm presenting a failure, I'm not presenting a success. It is very important to consider culture, music, and art. To consider especially how different cultures learn and how different cultures work together. And it's very important to consider about collaboration, especially when we're dealing with problems. Because creativity is also about being able to communicate, interact, negotiate. How do you negotiate a problem-solving technique with Western Europeans, Eastern Europeans, Asia or Africa? Different cultures mean different ways of communicating. And in order to be able to communicate, you have to be creative in adapting your style. I will do this slide and then I will pause for a minute because I need to ask a couple of questions. The incubation model of Paul Torrens involves three stages. One, incubation. Two, expectations. And then keep going. What do I mean by that? When you want creativity, you want to do it face to face. I'm saying to everybody, I'm going to show you something really spectacular. But that is the anticipation. Everybody wants to see what is spectacular. And then I pick it up by going constantly and saying, in the next slide or in the next few minutes, what we're going to see. But then it's about keeping it going. You need to be able that, you know, like more examples, more people to be working on that. So when you create creative curriculum, you need to consider what's the new thing that we're going to learn, how we're going to create opportunities for new learning, and how we keep going.
Sorry, the slides that you are showing, George, can you make it larger so that we see?
Larger.
Good.
Okay. Actually, that was a good point for you giving me the opportunity to pose a little bit. So basically, what I'd really like to do is, like, I would really like to ask one or two of you to tell me whether you think that you are creative, and or if you are creative in your class, tell me why you think you're creative in terms of the theory that we covered so far.
When you're creative in your class.
You don't have to answer this. Anyone who just feels that you're doing something creative, it doesn't have to be something huge.
It depends on the topic. If it enables me to be creative, sometimes maybe for some topic I'm not prepared to be creative. And the students, what important background information do they have about it? These are the most important. Sometimes I want to be creative, but they don't give me the chance.
Okay.
For example, also give them some freedom and give them choice of opportunity to solve the problem from the inside. And go to give them ready made answers.
Okay, I didn't get the second point because I think that we're far away from the microphone.
Sorry,
10 minutes,
there is some technical problem.
Because the projector.
Okay.
I remember one time I got really in trouble when I used to be in Manchester, and the reason is that I decided to take the students out because we had an amphitheater, but of course Manchester was raining all the time. So we got out there in order to discuss, and people really liked it, but then eventually it started raining. So that was me failing with a good idea. And then what we did is like the other opportunity that I had to be creative, and I'm going to show you that this example later on, is I asked once every month my students could stay at home, and we would log on through Second Life in a virtual world in the seminar. And actually, I thought that if I ask my students to stay at home, they wouldn't come to the seminar, but all of them they were in the virtual seminar, as we will see later on. Okay, next.
I think I'm creative as a teacher if I'm doing something new, maybe not generally, but with this particular group. What I have not done with this particular group and this new for the group. In that case, I believe that I'm creative.
That's a very good point. Good point. Yeah, because about new things. I have put together as many slides as I could for the theory, so you can actually have it after the presentation as well. Let me show you the next slide, which is about a list of things in terms of the creative thinking in the classroom. And basically what you have here is like you have you have people when they start working in creativity activities, which I really like. So people can actually write things, they can draw things and so on. And actually some of the key principles of creativity in this exercise that is shown here was about a belief that creative potential is inside everyone. That's very important, that we need to understand that everybody can be creative, some more creative than others. I don't think that I can teach somebody to be more creative, but if you have a little bit of the creative gene in you, and everyone should have, you can always try to expand and extend the application of creative thinking. Creativity can change things. So creativity seems to be a good thing. Mistakes should be celebrated, and we should learn from our mistakes. Creativity should be a natural response to boredom. That was a very interesting contribution from one of the people who contributed to that workshop. So the opinion was that people, if you are bored, you have nothing to be creative. And I can remember myself from my childhood how I was being creative with stuff that I had in my room to create new games. If you go to deprived countries where children do not have games or toys, they create something out of very basic ingredients just to keep themselves entertained. Positivity towards surprises. That's a very important thing about creativity, because it's about an attitude. If we don't like surprises, we're not likely to be creative minds. I don't like to surprise that much, but I like to give surprises. So I am creative as a teacher, but when my students are creative, I am a little bit like taken out of my comfort zone. So this is my weakness that I have, and I try to overcome every week I get in the class. We need to have an attitude towards openness of new ideas. Smart risk-taking. Please note, smart risk-taking. So a lot of people say, as I said before, you need to take risks, but you have to take smart risks. You have to have a contingency plan. Because when you're creative in education, if something doesn't work, then our students, our learners suffer. An attitude of non-judgment. If we do not understand something, that doesn't mean that it's not useful. It is creative in another way. We should be able to actively take ideas. We should be able to get our comfort zone and challenge it a little bit, to be able to see things that we are familiar with, but from a different perspective. And we should also be able to try with things that they haven't been done before. I'm not going to go through all the definitions, but I will just go into a couple of them. The first one, creativity is defined as the tendency to generate, recognize ideas, alternatives, possibilities that may be useful to solve problems. Creativity is the ability to find new solutions to a problem or new modes of expression, exactly what Nutella mentioned before. Creativity is the act of turning new and imaginative ideas into a reality. You see, the idea is that we consider creativity something new, but also the application of something new to existing problems. And it's very important to have implemented out of it. So, a summary of the boring part, and I do apologize for the boring part. And this is my view on creativity. Everyone has a creative side. I strongly feel that everybody can be creative, some more creative than others. I don't think that we can do creativity. I can teach people how to find their own path to creativity, but I don't think that I can teach creativity. There are so many people who have been world-renowned about creative minds. I think that it's all about teaching people how to find sources, and then they have to apply whether they can be creative and so on. Creativity, therefore, can be triggered. So we can actually create something for people to say, yes, I want to be more creative. And there is a waking up call. I think that waking up call about creativity is, it can be something. It can be a lecture like what we do now. It can be a workshop. To me, my waking up call to Kelly and Alejandro, they have the creativity workshop. I don't make any commission. I'm not just advertising these guys. It's just that I've been twice to their workshop. And these two guys, they dedicate the workshop to teaching individuals and groups about their creative processes. So the first time I've been in their creativity workshop, I remember the first few moments. I cried, I painted, I wrote, and as a matter of fact, they're the ones who actually helped me to get out of my academic frame of mind. Till that point, I had started two or three novels, and I've never gone past two or three pages. With them, I started writing my book, which is not finished yet, but it was like it was a wake-up call. I changed my life. I changed a lot of personal aspects of my life, but most importantly, I started writing. And sorry, I need to go on the side for a minute. I wanted to reach this. I don't know if you can see this. What do you think this is? That's my creativity stone. I took it from a beach in Hanya. While I was working, trying to be creative at the second workshop. And since then, every time I have associated this with a lot of thinking, seeing the sunset, seeing the, you know, like working about my problems in my life and so on. And eventually, this has actually moved into becoming something that I put in my hands. I hold it next to my soul, next to my heart. when I need to be creative. So if you like, it has become a comfort prop. So creativity can be associated with people, friends, even some artifacts. So let's try to be creative. What I cannot do this exercise with you. Natalia, I think I'm going to visit Kutaisi in a few weeks' time. If I'm in Kutaisi, I'm quite likely to just drop in Tbilisi for a couple of days. If I'm there, we can actually, you can book a room and you can do this exercise. What I do as part of this exercise, when I do this lecture face to face, I light up candles. There is a very nice smell around the room. I put very relaxed music, and I'm asking you to have a yoga mat and a towel. And you put the towel behind your head so you can have it as a pillow, but also you have another towel that you can cover your face or your body. I know it will sound weird. I don't know what I'm going to say.
Maybe a key comment. You mentioned that we can't teach creativity, and I largely agree to it. But unfortunately, we as teachers and we as parents can kill creativity. And this is what we very often do.
Yeah, this is what I think. Like, the open, I cannot teach you how to be creative, but I can teach you how to reach creativity. And it's my responsibility to give you, as you said, the fuel. I need to trigger creativity. So this is why I strongly feel that we can trigger creativity. And once we trigger creativity, we need to keep it alive. Yes? Sorry, there is a little bit of echo from your sound. So if I pause for a minute, I hear myself two or three times. Okay, so this is an image I have from Creep. And what you have there is a look about, you know, like a very lovely beach. And what you do is like, I usually put this image on the projector and I put some nice music and scented candles, a towel for people to cover themselves, because the last thing that you want is to lie down next to everyone. So what I would do is like, if we were together, I would have asked you to move on the side of the table. And of course, if we have the vice rector research there, that's a very awkward position to be asked the vice rector to be sleeping next to the colleagues. But this is creativity fueling and triggering. So it's a good thing that we're doing this remotely and not face to face, because by now you would see me lying down. I would have a towel because I don't feel comfortable for other people to see me. So the lights will be down. And then what you do is like, it would be breathing exercises. So this is a thing that we did at the creativity workshop, and sometimes I do it when I think others. So what I do is like, it's a very interesting that you know, like, you can observe that, but usually when I train others, I do not observe. But I've done a couple of sessions which were about research. So I said to the people, would you mind if I observe you? And I got permission. And it's very interesting to see how tense everybody gets to be, because some people will wear a tie, other people are more relaxed, some people are very reserved. Then you have the crazy people who love things like that. But then eventually the point is to go into breathing exercises. And then what you do is like, you just go into a breathing exercise and say, take a deep breath and breathe in and breathe out. And you do this for 5 minutes. And after the 5 minutes, people get to be relaxed. And then you ask them to clear away their thoughts of the daily problems. And after the breathe in and the breathe out, then you actually tell them about a story. You can describe a journey as they do in usually, you know, like in various counseling sessions. So you can actually tell people to clear their mind and think that they are in a meadow and they walk. And the more that you walk, they go towards a big tree that it's far, far away. And they keep walking with some of their friends around and so on. So you paint a good picture. And the reason why you want to paint this picture is because before you ever start working on creativity, you want people to be comfortable and forget about the daily routine. This is why it's very important, if you want to have a workshop on creativity, to have it outside other lectures. Have it on a away day or have it on a Friday afternoon where people can go home or they can go for coffee and relax and consider, how can I build up for this? So this is... This is the first thing that Sorry, what did you say? Sorry. Sorry, it's my sound again. Okay, so now going back to what the topics that we wanted to do is like creating an authentic instruction. We're going to cover then the characteristics of creativity, and then the final part is with more specific things and so on. Okay. Creative thinking, according to Funko, creative thinking can be developed over time. And in order for this to happen, we need to consider the process. We have preparation, incubation, insight, evaluation, and elaboration. So the concept is preparation. We need to be prepared for a creative process, especially about an authentic instruction. We need to consider how we can do that. Incubation means that we have to have a team of creative minds who can work together. The insight is to be able to consider whether we can develop it, whether we can part it, take it as part of our company. Evaluate whether it worked or not. It could be that our students are not ready for it. For example, creative scenarios for IT students, they may be different than business students, and they may be different from education students or arts. And we have to consider about the elaboration, how we can actually evolve it further and how we can actually take it one step further. I'm pretty sure that you have a challenge-based learning term that was in Johnson's work. So the focus there is like giving the students opportunity to focus on a challenge of global significance. So the concept of challenge-based learning is that this is a problem everybody has. And then the next thing is apply how to develop local solutions. So how would you solve this? So the focus of challenge-based learning is to direct their own research into real-world matters and consider in a critical framework how to apply what they learn. So the idea of creativity is that I give you the theory, and then you go away and you'll say, how will I get to be creative in my own class? So what I'm going to do now is like I'm going to show you an example from the Education Foundation, an example of how you engage students in active learning through authentic instruction. So the activity, it looks about authentic instruction and how you can engage students in active learning. The idea of this scenario, unfortunately, I cannot play the videos for you. The idea is that you show to the students a scenario, a teaching example from three classrooms. And then what you do is like you review the elements of authentic instruction. You read what happened in every classroom. And then the students have to give answers in terms of what part of the instruction was authentic instruction or not. By the way, you do not need to find exact videos. You can create videos yourselves. I do a lot of video recording myself in the class. So you could create scenarios to help people with instruction. Let's see the elements of authentic instruction first. The authentic instruction consists of five elements. Higher order thinking, what is that? That is the concept of higher order thinking is to be able to get critical thinking. Do I learn? Am I learning right now? What do I learn? What part is useful? What is not useful? Depth of knowledge. A part of the authentic instruction is to have comprehensive learning about the topic that are covered. Third, real world connection. Whatever I teach to my students in class, they have to be able to apply it in a real world scenario. Substantive conversation. We need to discuss about what I do with my students, and social support to be able to find inclusion in terms of whatever you learn. It's very important for society. You have to be part of society. You have to solve a general problem and so on. So these are parts of authentic instruction. Do you have any comments so far? Your views of authentic instruction, agree, disagree, before we go to the example? No?
We agree.
Okay, good. Okay, here are three videos. The first video. There were probing questions to guide students in a discussion about the winter solstice, winter holidays in different cultures. You could do this video yourself. So in other words, you can go with children, or this work for younger students, of course, pupils, and you will say, what do you think people do over winter? Or what happens at Christmas? So you could discuss about how Christmas is cold, but then you can actually tell them, what about the southern part of the world, where Australia, during Christmas, they have they go to the beach because it's warm, because it's the summertime. So basically, if you play the video, see what discussion has happened, you can actually find out whether there are elements of authentic instruction from the video. The good thing about this, it helps people who observe the video to consider whether this is instruction or not. For example, from this experiment, there was evidence for depth of knowledge. The teacher challenges students to master abstract concepts about life. There was conversation. Students reveal what they've learned. And social support. The teacher encouraged students to participate and help them to encourage the discussion. So the students became part of the social group, the learning group. So that is an example of how creativity helps with authentic instruction. So the guy went there, opened up the discussion, gave them a challenging question, and actually introduced students into a Q&A, questions and answers, and it was very reassuring. Engage a student in active learning through authentic instruction. Questions from early explorers to other themes and disciplines, such as geography and economics. So basically, what it was like, a teacher there tried to touch different areas and how you can explore new solutions in economics and geography or even politics, so different disciplines. And these were the ways that you could actually, for example, conversation content is taught and reviewed in an active question and answer form. So it's very important to consider scenarios, set them up, show them to people, and then ask them whether this is authentic instruction and so on. The third example, a teacher used examples from previous and current farming practices in order to teach students in agriculture-based community about change over time. And authentic instruction would be if students could make comparisons and distinctions between past and present, whether the students would be able to go through the cycle about how things change. And real-world connection is the fact that you use an example that students can be familiar with. So these are some ways of how you can actually engage students in active learning. I have another set of examples. Michigan State University. They've done a series of interviews with the best teachers of the year between 2000 and 2010 in the US. And then they have interviewed them in order to identify the five guidelines for creative teaching. So what I will do now, bear with me, I have five slides where these teachers give examples of how they can be creative. First of all, the researchers identified the first guideline was that you need to connect your interest with your teaching. I will say something from my own perspective. I have done I have done 8 degrees. I have done a bachelor, I have done a PhD, an MBA, and 5 masters. And I'm a professional student myself. I study a lot. But one of the most important things I've ever done in my life was to do something that I cannot associate my life with. So when I teach computer science, and I teach the hard elements of computer science, I'm very bored because that's not exciting to me. But because my main focus is how to use computers to improve human lives, when I teach that, then I'm far more creative. It's very interesting to me. So this is what the first guideline is. Connect your interests with your teaching. So if I leave you to read, guys, can you read that? Is that visible? Is that visible? This is what a teacher said, one of the examples. If you can read your own, the 3-4 lines. Says, I think we teach who we are, and I know that I think who I am. So, do you have an idea of how we try this in class? How would you teach? I mean, I'll give you an example of mine, and then you can give me yours. What I do is, like, I always make sure that I provide part of my life in my class. So, if I don't like a method, I say that I don't like my method. If I disagree with the way that a certain phenomenon has taken place in society, I put that in my class. Because then my students understand whether I'm a Democrat or not, whether I am an authoritarian person or not, whether I'm, if you like, extrovert or introvert. So what I usually do is, like, when I teach them about things that relate to anything, I am very open in terms of how I feel about it. That helps me be creative. This is how I do it in my own class. Can someone tell me, in your class, how would you connect your interest with your teaching?
When I teach new topic to my pilots, I always, from the very beginning of the classes, I inform that we are going to do, for instance, in terms of listening task, that I will bring the materials from the book and I can bring, and I will bring for authentic materials from live media communication. But I offer them, if they have additional sources, they can bring them and we can discuss them together, because they are already sometimes active pilots, sometimes they are initial pilots, and all of them merged experience. I learned from them as well, and I thought that maybe I can do something that you are interested in more while studying, while I'm delivering a class for you. So I offer my experience, my approach of teaching method, and I offer them to provide their interest as well, to inform me what they would like to do, sometimes more in the part of listening, more in the part of speaking, or whatever they would like to do additionally. So this is
That's excellent. Thank you. Thanks for sharing this.
It's always because they are more interested and engaged in, while learning.
Okay. Should I go to the next? Should I go to the next one? So we'll have one example on eight.
So when I give them, so when we just discuss some new material for the next day, I always ask them to make small presentation. It's not exactly the presentation with the very beginning and summary and so on, but just to bring some information, some special information that they have, just several slides, some pictures, and give the description of it and inform us about that. So this improves their speaking skills very much. And for military students, as I already mentioned, I teach at the military university. So the speaking skill and listening skill is very important.
Actually, yeah, very good, yeah. So with, let me go to the next one. So you see, it's very different perspectives of, you know, like two or three people making things. I mean, one of the things that I really like a lot is sports, and also try to use examples of sports because some of my students love sports, so it helps. The second guideline is link lessons to real world learning. Is it visible? Can you read it? Okay. I like the first one.
Your sound has disappeared.
My what? Your sound
has disappeared. You want them to speak again?
Sorry, I cannot hear you. Mehmet, can you hear me?
Sorry?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So the link lessons to real world. So if you read this, the first one, it says how this teacher takes the kids to discuss about the weather. So when the first bell would ring, they would spread out in the school courtyard, would talk about the clouds. It's interesting to see how people will talk about, the students will talk about the weather and the impact and so on. The second one is about they create non-profit organizations. And then what they do is that they actually do interviews, and then they try to get funding. So you see, this is a real world experience. So they try to simulate something that happens in real life, which is amazing, which is good. So how would, can you give me an example from the discipline that you teach? How would you make it real world learning? So how will you make sure that you will link your subject in your class with something that happens in the real world? Anybody?
As for me, I'm teaching English for specific purposes, mainly I'm in business English, and we are having such cases like simulations more than case studies. So simulations, we have something like this. I make them create some kind of organization, and they have projects to name the organization, to create the special terms, and to have the interview there, hiring and firing people, as well as thinking about how to improve and develop their company. So this is more about like simulation. It helps a lot in my case.
Yeah. And you see how challenging it is. It's very challenging to create an association with the real world. You have to be, you have to prepare. That's why we have authentic instruction, because you have to prepare of how to do this scenario in order to make sure that it is realistic with the real world. Cultivating a creative mindset. And this is the creative mindset. I mean, it's very important. You know, like, I have to admit, I look weird when I go around my house and having this in my hand. So sometimes I play with my worry bits, and actually I'm always trying to be creative, having different techniques that we will see next. It can be challenging. But as you can see here, how can I relate that to teaching? I am always on the lookout for ideas. So sometimes you can see me working around, taking notes on my mobile phone, thinking that that's a great idea. Or I would read the news and I will start cutting parts of newspapers and say, I need to teach people doing that. The other day I went to a supermarket, and in the UK now what we have is like, we have to shop, the shop and go. I don't know if you have this in Georgia yet, but shop and go is that I take a barcode reader and I have it on my shopping cart, and I walk around the supermarket. So I get the milk, I scan it. So I scan everything before I put them in the bag. So I have bags in the shopping cart, and I scan them as I go, and then when I go to the checkout, the only thing that I do is pay. And once every 10 people, they will just randomly take the bag to check whether I have actually lied or if I scanned everything. So when I saw that, I looked at the till, and one of the things that I realized that was difficult to handle was the security element. So I took that opportunity and I took some pictures and I went to the class and said, guys, this is what I realized. You know, like, let's try to use this scenario and let's try to see whether we can break the system. So that was me being always in a creative mindset. Can someone give me an example of how you make sure that you're always in a creative mindset?
Push them in emergent thinking, and
analyze the whole experience of the class.
Yeah.
And we can then choose.
That's a good one. The fact that you are with others trying to work things out together. What I usually do is like I will not apologize for saying this, but I always try to steal ideas from more creative people. So every day I try to spend as much time as I can with people who know more than I do or they are more creative. I admire them and I always try to get into the frame of mind that they are. So it's nothing but with just being together with creative people as well. Value collaboration, you need to understand how valuable collaboration is. Anytime you have brains focusing on one idea, the potential is exponential. And this is another example, you can read that. You see, I really like what this person did there. We started a group at my school for teachers. We began to meet in my classroom once a month. Everyone sticking to the rule that in order to go to the meeting, everybody was supposed to bring something new, something of their own. So we could share ideas and find out anyone has been successful in other classrooms. Do you have anything like this? Do you think it would work at Ibsu? That's possibly a question for Natella, I don't know. Natella, would you think that people would share? If you ask them to get in a room once every month and say, can you share good practice and bring something new? Do you think that people will open up and do that? Maybe you already do that.
It depends on the teacher. Some teachers won't share anything, especially if they see they haven't done something good. But majority of young teachers usually are very open and very ready to share. And they are very happy to share because they may be inwardly hesitating. I even did something, but is it really new? Is it really good?
Yeah.
And when they share, they understand that it is really good,
yeah,
probably, and that it is really new, probably. So younger teachers are usually happy to share.
Maybe they just want to prove that they invented something that everybody knows.
Well, sometimes it's a question of ambition, but
yeah.
But older teachers are also ambitious, don't be afraid of it.
Also, at Middlesex, what we have is like we have the sharing your experience, show and tell. So the show and tell is a series of sessions where you just show up and you tell what you're doing. And it's for me it works because I'm one of the university's teaching fellows. Teaching fellow is a if you like, it's like an award for teaching excellence. So people are very very fond of their teaching practice. They share because they get, they're being recognized at the professional level. Okay, the final guideline is take intellectual risk. So one of the teachers said that they want to create an environment where students feel to be able to make mistakes and also learning from the mistakes. Now, the problem I have is that if I ask my students to be creative and they fail on what they attempt, they may fail my module, and I don't want that. I don't want them to fail the course. So in certain courses, what I've done is like I've included an element that has no summative grade. In other words, it does not count. And I do this because I want my students to fail. And that gives them the opportunity of failing and learning from their mistakes without losing any marks. So that is a little bit of ability to take intellectual risks. Can you tell me with the show of hands, how many of you really like to take risks, even if it means that you're going to fail and your colleagues will see that you failed? Can I just say, I'm not raising my hand anymore. I used to do it. But the more responsible I am to show that what good practices are, I feel more afraid. So I used to be the first one. Now I'm one of the last people who raise their hands in the room. So I'm not such a big risk taker because there is a big impact also on my role in the university. So I have seen this change in my life, and I can see that the older I get or the more responsibilities I get in the institution, the more scary it becomes to fail. I'm not scared, so I don't risk anymore, but it's become scarier. Okay, let's try to start now if we are creative or not. Okay, at this point, I will ask Mehmet to help me out. This is an opportunity to do a little bit of an activity. It takes longer, but I don't want you to do the entire activity. But what there are is like there are two surveys. I've given you the links. Mehmet, if you'll take a minute, you click on the link should be testmycreativity.com.
Yes.
If you click start the test.
Yeah.
Okay, let's try to do this together.
Start with just one, your age, yes?
Yes, yeah. So my age is 41 to 50.
Okay.
I have lived the most of my life in the United Kingdom.
Choose.
I have a PhD and I work in education academic. Number 5 is computer and information systems. Mm-hmm. And I have over 20 years of experience.
In which industry do you work?
Education, academic training.
Uh-huh. And what type of role?
Computer and information systems.
Sorry?
Computer and information systems.
Okay.
And
have you worked in this role?
Unfortunately, over 20. I'm too old now. Over 20.
Over 20. Okay, next.
Yeah. So, what I'd like to do is like you can see the questions. On a typical day at work, do you consider yourself a person who is thorough? I don't know. You can choose what you want to put. So, Mehmet, I'm putting this to you, 7 to 11. Just drag it wherever you want to be.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
A person who likes frequent change.
I don't know. It's up to you.
Okay. A person who cannot...
This is your activity, guys. I was going to do this myself, but I won't do it because I cannot see.
A person who can always see both sides or change. This one? Okay. A person
who likes to work on one thing at a time towards the end, not really.
Okay. A person who loves more than.
Most people, more or less at the beginning.
Okay.
A little bit. Okay.
Next. Okay. A person who enjoys working with people from different disciplines and skills.
Yes.
Okay. A person who believes story repeats itself. Okay. A person who believes rules exist for good reasons.
Not sure.
Okay. A person who likes to be a part of the system. Okay. A person who likes to operate on the basis of
instinct and gut action. Well, maybe somewhere in the middle of a little bit fast.
Okay. Next. Okay,
a person who gets green or things that are not, I don't know, who likes to change the situation there.
Person who
is eager there.
Okay, a person
likes
who
to work puzzles, probably.
Are we doing this for Nutella then? Is this a Nutella's profile?
No, it's yours as much as I know you. likes to see the bigger picture.
Bigger picture. Okay, next. 22.
Who likes to make controversial statements just to provoke,
A person who regularly turns for advice,
more or less. The person who holds back their ideas
until they are asked
for. A person who can always dig their way out of a hole, I believe so.
Yeah.
That's true.
How many questions do we have, Mr. George?
A person who likes to see concrete proof before they believe what they're told. More or less. A person who likes to find shortcuts, maybe. A person who goes along with the flow. Come back. A person who is good at getting their own way. Yes. A person who aims for stability. I'm not sure. In the middle.
Okay. Well, this one, look, number 32 now. Which of these ones connect to both submarine and camera?
Submarine and camera.
That's for the thing. Guys, this is for you. Just to keep you awake. So what is the answer there?
Watertight, film, lens, battery,
okay.
Door.
But does a submarine have a film? Guys, the question is, from the seven words, how many of them can be used to describe both a submarine and a camera?
Maybe one says
number 33. Which of these words do you think connect to both radio and knife?
Telescope, radio,
telescope,
radio.
How is telescope related to
knife?
No, radio.
Okay,
what about C?
Wait, may I ask you something? Guys, I'm losing control of the class. Wait. May I ask you something? Why would telescope be relevant to knife or radio? Tell me. Don't forget that this is about creativity. I'll give you an example. A creative student would say, the other day I was looking through my telescope, rather than looking at the stars, I saw a lady sitting at the beach with a radio, and then a thief came with a knife. You see my point? So it's completely unorthodox way of thinking. But you see, we laugh because we say, no, nobody's going to think about that. But the creative mind would say, no, we're thinking outside of the box. So I really want you to think. We can put randomly, Mehmet, you can put randomly some text, but you know, that's the point of that page. Okay. If we'll go to the next page, click something on everything. So I want to go to next page, which is 37, 38. Do you see these?
Yes. Okay, next page.
37, what do you see? Okay, what about 38?
Not moon, but half moon, probably.
No, these are just these are just examples. They're not supposed to be cut moon or sun. What do you see on 38?
Yeah, profiles of two people in the
it's a bottle and a funnel.
So I didn't hear that.
Some
planes. Okay. Click next.
Okay.
39.
39, okay, that's, yeah. Okay.
And number 40, and then you click finish.
I done as many uses of breathing that you can think of.
Not break.
Do we need to write? What?
Not break.
Have you pressed finish? Okay, guys, please, can you click finish? Damn it.
Okay. Finish.
Yes, please. Creativity is over for this exercise.
Okay.
Do you see the radar diagram?
Yes, you 75.77. Your creativity score is 75.77.
It's very low. It's very low. You put me very low. usually I go above the typical values there. But anyway, it depends really what you're going to put there. But it's very interesting to see that score because it shows the different metrics in terms of persistence, complexity, paradox, perspective, curiosity, abstraction, and connection. So that shows you, actually, this is a scientific approach. So basically, if you read more, you will see it's a more scientific approach. So let me go back to the presentation, please, if you don't mind. But that gives you, and you will have the link. I'll show you where you have the link. Okay. Can you see the presentation now?
Yes.
Okay. Natella, the time is 14 past 4. So I have around 20, 25 minutes left here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. So the snowflake model of creativity is based on David Perkins's 6 traits. And these are the ones, and the concept is that you have a snowflake. So it's similar to the radar diagram. So the more you are on each one of them, the snowflake becomes bigger and bigger. So the bigger the snowflake, the bigger the creativity. But snowflake, it's not round. It can be an anomalous shape based on what you are more. So the model elements is one of the first one, strong commitment of a personal aesthetic. So they enjoy a challenge of struggling through chaos. So it means that the more you are ready to have more disorganization trying to find a solution, the more creative you're likely to be. This is why we have the stereotype of artists or creative thinkers to be, untidy hair, painters who are, randomly picking through the papers and so on. The ability to excel in finding problems. So a lot of creative thinkers are scientists. Another stereotype like Einstein. I don't care about my hairdo. I just think about the creative solution of the problem that I have. Mental mobility. Creative people have a strong tendency to think in opposites or contraries. So basically, you can use analogies, examples, metaphors. I do this a lot of in my class to give certain examples, and I'm trying to prepare a solution to something of a real-world scenario to help students understand. Willingness to take risks, we cover that. Creative people not only scrutinize and judge their ideas, but they also seek criticism. So creative thinkers are the people will say, tell me what you think, and I agree or disagree with you, and so on. And the final trait of creative thinkers is the inner motivation. In other words, there is an inherent motivation in terms of people want to be creative because they can't stand still. They dislike boredom. Okay. A little bit of quote, Georges Bernanson, some men see things as they are and say why. I dream of things that never were and say why. Why not? So basically, this is why not should be there. So that is the view. Why not doing something else? So in other words, it's thinking outside of the box. We are able as creative thinkers to see something that the rest of the world cannot see. We are able to go and create something out of thin air. We are ready to go there and say, okay, this is how you've been teaching so far. I'm not going to do the same. I'm going to do something differently. So what we'll do here is like we'll go through a list of characteristics. A creative thing, individual values, intellectual and cognitive matters in terms of thinking. Independence and autonomy, not liking to be part of a structure. Express ideas well. Creativity is all about being articulate also in the way that you express things. And if you're not good with words, you may be good with designs, but something to express what's in your mind. Being productive, getting things done through creative ways. Philosophical problems. Creative thinkers are also considered to be quite religious or critical of religion. Also critical of the meaning of life. Being able to create, you know, like their the footprint on philosophy. High aspiration of self. This is not being selfish. A lot of people think creativity is associated with selfishness. It's not that. It's thinking that I have something to say. It's not necessarily that I have better views than you, but I have also views which I want to share. A lot of interest, different range of interests. For example, I play the music, I do sport, and I read literature. So this is a big range there. It's like, I'm not saying that I'm the most creative person there. Judging from the test you did, I'm far below than average. But a lot of interests generally are associated with creative thinkers. Interesting person, straightforward, and also ethically consistent manner, has consistent personal standards. In other words, a creative thinker is quite likely to say, you know, like to be able to be critical, whether they're creative or not. So there is a lot of ethical standards there. Sorry. So some characteristics of the creatively gifted. They're independent, divergent, self-actualizers, aesthetically inclined. They have ability to see strong images, to see images and so on. Unaffected by peer pressure. I like that. I like this with myself. If I'm in a meeting and everybody else says, no, this is not the opinion that we want, I'm not being stubborn, but I'll say, okay, at least I need to express my view is different. There's no way that you can actually set me up in a meeting if I think that I need to put something in the minutes. Okay. Negative aspects of creative people. They can be stubborn because they may think that something has to be said. Can I just say something? If you are stubborn as a person, do not use my slides as an excuse to say, no, I'm not stubborn, I'm really creative underneath. So that, okay. They challenge authority because usually authority is associated with systems and the creative mind wants to break the boundaries of system. They can be unconventional and unfortunately uncooperative. What does it mean? It means that if a system is in place for requiring certain types of cooperation, maybe the creative person doesn't want to be cooperative in that front. They can be assertive and cynical in the way that they express the views. And they can be sloppy or careless if they want to think creatively and they forget the level of detail that is required. They can ask questions all the time, but that means that sometimes they may challenge why that rule is there. They can be quite psychothemic. It can be like going into moody and therefore temperamental and can be withdrawn if they think that there is no room to create, to express their creative side. Oh, I have more people there.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. I'll take a screenshot of that. I haven't seen them before.
Well, they were still at the conference, which was just over. That's why they couldn't come.
That's fine. Okay. The good thing is that we're recording the session, so you will be able to see what you've missed. This slide also has some additional traits: fluency, being flexible, creating novel ideas, fill in the details by elaborate, and redefine, change the way of thinking, and see from a provide a different alternative perception. The first link is the link that we've done, the test. The creativity quiz, to tell you the truth, is not as good. It only has 10 questions, but it's for fun. So you can do it at your own time. You have the links there. Okay. So now the final part, we have just about 15 minutes. And let's try to see how we can facilitate creative thinking. Okay. I have a collection of exercises here. So there are, first of all, I don't know if you cover in your curriculum Edward Bono, which is all about, the guy is all about lateral thinking. And I like lateral thinking, although I've been criticized in terms of lateral thinking can be taken other ways apart from the most walked way. Why do some people always seem to be having new ideas while others or of equal intelligence never do? So the key stages of lateral thinking is impregnation. So consider a problem under various aspects. So then divergence. Move away, confront the problem, and try to come up with as many original ideas as possible. Then three, convergence. Take the ideas into solutions. And fourth, evaluate the solutions. So that is lateral thinking. Lateral thinking, if you like, is quite associated with creative thinking. So these are a series of 14 exercises. We're not going to cover all 14 exercises, but we have some examples. Use your five senses to inspire yourself from the things that you see. So look around you. You remember what I've done here? I'm using touch. I'm touching the stone. I'm looking at the stone, and then I'm trying to come up with ideas. Use a dictionary to come up with ideas, or a book. Turn a book page, go to a specific page, go find random words and try to come up with ideas. Use an analogy or a metaphor. Or create a brainstorming session and find five words that are relevant to a problem you have in class. For example, I have a very disruptive student in my class. Let's try to see how I can pick that class without the disruptive student affecting me. And then define a customer journey or product's life cycle. Some exercise. Says the internet, write the six-word story of the problem. So express your problem in six words. Create a mind map. That would be different views, so you can actually see. Create a mind map of your next week's lecture. So see, this is a mind map. If the mind map is too confusing, it means that you're trying to cover too many things in 1 hour. So that's not good. If the mind map is very narrow, it means that you're not discussing actually the problem, so you need to be more creative. Start writing about something, but don't stop. It's an auto writing, automatic writing or automatic drawing. Automatic drawing is when you close your eyes and you draw something on a piece of paper, and then you try to make something sense out of it. Automatic writing is about writing. Think of only one thing and start writing about this, and then try to read it if it makes sense. But don't try to think. Role storming, roles. Think that you are your boyfriend or girlfriend. So that will give you a different perspective. Think that you're a customer, think you're a colleague. Think you are your enemy. And then write your note. Think of what everybody else would do and do the opposite. That's reverse thinking. Meet people you don't know. I've been doing this when I fly. I fly a lot for my university and business and all the projects that I do. I think that I fly once or twice every month, sometimes three or four times a month. So what I usually do is, like, when I fly, I always talk to people. Most of the people I talk to are very scared. I don't care. I won't see them again. Actually, because I fly to Athens a lot, sometimes I've seen these people and I can see that some of them we start discussing in the lounge, or some of them completely try to disappear because they're afraid of the weird people, the weird person who was talking to them. But when you meet different people, you get different opinions and you talk about problems. Edward Bowman has created the six hats of different kinds of attitudes: neutrality, emotions, negative criticism, positive criticism, creativity, and organization. Green, which by the way is my favorite color, seems that you have a very, so if you have a green hat on, you're very creative, lots of crazy dreams and ideas. So look it up, the resource is there, so you can see how this exercise works more. So what I will do now, some case study from using the technology in a creative way. And Natella, you told me that you need another session, right? Natella, you wanted another session like this?
Maybe when you come.
Okay, but the idea is that on the second session, I was going to give more examples. So now what I'll do is, like, for the next 10 minutes, I will give you some very specific actions that I do in my class for creativity, but also how I use technology. So, virtual learning works. I have created a virtual world in Second Life, and my students can get into this virtual world in their avatars, and they can get into the different rooms, and by being in the different rooms, they learn different things. So basically, this is my second world, and this is how the students work there as avatars. That helped me to introduce students to a new environment, and the students, instead of coming to the class once every month, as I told you, they stay in their home, and they look online and they use the avatar. That has helped shy students to talk to me, students who were very bored with the lectures to participate, people who are afraid of asking questions to ask questions because I could not see their face, and has actually generated a way of communicating and actually participating in multiple choice questions, quizzes, and so on. So that was a creative way of using a virtual learning world in order for students to communicate. If you have questions, please interrupt me. Now, this is a creative spell. That's an exercise that I would ask you to do. If I was there, I will ask you remotely. Send a postcard to a student of yours who failed. They failed your module, they need to retake the module next term. They have never missed a lecture or seminar and they do everything you ask them to do, but they still fail. So tell the student how you feel about it, and make the student a promise for the next term. That's an exercise to take at home, because that will help you think from their side. They were always there. They were always there because they had to sign their name. And I know that in Georgia, it's very important for people to attend sessions. So the students are there and sign their names, but they still fail. Write a letter to them, not a letter, a postcard, because a postcard is short. So you only have space for two or three sentences. Tell them how you feel. Give them a promise. Keep the promise. See the result next time. Ask the student to keep this postcard with them. That's an idea. I'm not saying to do it. Maybe you get in trouble. I know that I've done it in the past. Another case study, computer-supported cooperative work. I'm not going to go through the text. I'm going through the images because I'm running out of time. I ask my students to work remotely a lot. And because we use technology, what they do is the students, they write notes. And we do this with social media as well and social networks. So basically what they do is, like, the students type their questions and answers. And what they do is, like, I can actually do visualizations of which group is better than others or which day is more busy than others. You see here? So here are the four groups, and all these four groups, they have a different peak time, but most of them peak around this deadline. Then what you do is, like, you can actually see the total posts from the groups. These are four groups, 458, 459, 60, and 61. These are four groups. And you can see the peak of each group and each individual student. And then you can see the post per group. This particular one, this is an exercise that we did in Germany with Egyptian and Palestinian students. And they did it remotely. So this is a creative way of showing how people communicate with each other. You see this diagram here? Each node is a student from a different group. And the more two students discuss with each other, the thicker the line is. Can you see here? So basically what you have here is like between these, because basically what you have is like the purple circles are students and the orange circles are posts. So this particular student has written so many posts for a thread called meeting, while this student only sent one message. Now here, this student with this student exchanged only one post, while you have more students, this student with this student communicated for this post several times. It meant that they were discussing. That's a creative way of showing how people communicate in my class. So I can see who talks to whom, how they exchange information, and why they exchange information the way that they do. Okay, that is one of my favorite creative exercises. Sorry, Natella, did you say something?
No.
Sorry, I don't hear voices. It's just it's the echo, and I think that you're asking questions. Sorry. This is my favorite exercise. I wish we could do it together. Do you see stuff here from your school days? Yes, pencil. Okay. So what I usually do, I take stuff like this. I give them to everyone. You hold them, you smell them, you touch them, and then I ask you to remember your early years. I want you to remember when you went with your parents to get your school supplies. And I want you to remember your favorite teacher, and especially something very special that they taught you. And remember what made it so memorable. I always remember my grandmother, who was with my mother, because I'm the fourth generation of educators in my family. I always remember my mother and my grandmother. Specifically from my grandmother, I remember her how she was telling me how to hold the pencil and try to draw, but also how to use the scissors in order to cut things randomly, to do collages. Till now, every time I use scissors, I remember my grandmother. So to me, that was special because that was one of my first teachers. It's very important to remember. And if you do this exercise, I guarantee that you will remember one of your first teachers and you will remember their faces. It's very important to consider how these strong associations work in the rest of our lives. The way the creativity works, especially at school, is important. By fueling creativity, using Natella's verbs, by fueling creativity, I'm using my words, by triggering creative styles, we can help somebody to be a creative person. Although the memory is stronger when we are 4, 5, 6 years old, it's still there if we are 20 years old. So I urge you to find ways to wake up the creativity of your students. I do this a lot with social learning networks. So what I do is like I use Facebook and Twitter, and I'm giving them an opportunity to write things. And what happens is like you can actually see how the network users, they have peaks on Facebook. So how they talk more. So these are activities that students talk more compared to these. This is another activity that I do with my students. I ask you to get a raisin and I ask you to get any kind, you know, like a walnut, chestnuts, you know, anything that, you know, like anything that it's not as soft as the raisin. Can you please compare the difference between raisin and the nut in terms of the look, feel, smell, and taste? Tell me. The exercise is usually, I ask you to close your eyes, so I'm putting you blindfolds, and then I give you these. And then I'm asking you to look, first of all, I'm asking you to look at it, but then what I do is like, there are different variations. When you're blindfolded, you have to feel it, smell it, and then taste. But a lot of people don't like blindfolds, so therefore I have changed the activity so you can look at it. But the ideal exercise with this is to ask people to be blindfolded, then they touch it. And then you can describe them in a way that it smells and tastes. Now, you can compare them with students. Your first student is someone who is a soft person. It's easy to push it in your hand, to push it. It's easy to, if you like, it's easy to eat it. And it tastes, you know, like interesting. That would be a student who is easy manipulated into your content. The second student is hard. It has a very strong taste. And after 10 minutes, you still having it in your mouth because you cannot swallow everything. It's a difficult student. It's a student who will have to understand the learning difference. You have to understand why the student is not absorbing as easily as the other student. It's very important for you to eat both A and B. Both of them are good for your health. You are stuck with student A and student B. Both of them are in the class. So you have to be able to find a creative way to teach both. You have to be creative in order to be able to deliver for both students. I'm finishing in a couple of minutes. This is an experiment that I was running with my students. These were computer forensic students, and I used KPMG and Ernst & Young in assessment. These are students who were doing computer forensic. So my students were playing, it was a role-playing game. So basically what we did with my students is like, I told them to pretend that they were investigating. So what they've done is like, created a design of how the laboratory they investigated was like. They pretended that the police officers who went to an internet cafe to get some illegal activity, to catch some illegal activity going on. They created a Facebook account and they were actually taking pictures of the crime committed. Like this student is giving something illegally to the other student. They took pictures of the laboratory. These are all members of staff who pretended to be criminals. This is one of the teachers who actually was a suspect arrested by police. And that was diagrams showing how the people communicated. So you see, this shows how the students got crazy about the idea. They became creative. So, to conclude with the last thing, so it's like we're spot on, it's 40 minutes past. Creativity is the supreme art of the teacher to awaken joy in creative expression and knowledge. And that was said by Albert Einstein. I don't know whether I agree entirely. I know that I believe teaching isn't art. I don't think that everybody can talk. I don't think that everybody can teach the same in the same way. Teaching has to be a joy for us. One of the first papers I did in 2002 is how to create. How to teach programming as a joyful task. And most importantly, teaching is important to be able to create an environment where a student can be creative in trying to find knowledge. And the only way that a student can become creative in the classroom is that if the instructor is creative. So it's very important for us to find ways to understand creativity and try to introduce creativity in a teaching scenario. Okay. Do you have any final questions? This I will conclude. I will conclude my.
Not a question, but a request. As you are coming in a couple of weeks.
No, not coming in a couple of weeks. I may come in a few weeks. I'm not so sure yet. I need to check with Archer.
Well, if you come.
Okay.
What if you give some. Little by volume, but quite creative task to our doctoral students.
Yep.
And when, if you come, we arrange a sort of presentation of what they have created. And probably they should create something small, like a 3-minute thing, not more, but to demonstrate their creativity.
Okay, my suggestion is regardless whether they are or not, What they could do is we can arrange a creative activity that they will have to do. They will have to do it, let's say, in 60 to 90 seconds, and they can create a video of it, which we can assess either I'm there or not. If I'm there, we can do it on the spot. If not, they can create the video and we can assess it online.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
You see, Natella, that was Natella, that was a creative idea.
So you have to create a little video and drop a minute to a minute and a half, which somehow creatively influence your teaching. You can do it during your class or, I don't know, not during the class, but to demonstrate what kind of creative teaching you use or you suggest, okay?
May I suggest something? Because you don't want it to be scary, you can just use your mobile phone. It doesn't have to be a professional video. Just prepare something that your friend can record on a mobile phone in 60 seconds or 90 seconds.
Uh-huh. And you can do it here. So two people together do it, it should be from 2 minutes to 3 minutes. If one person creates it, it should be from a minute.
Natella, don't give them more than 60 seconds. Make it challenging, 60 seconds. 1 minute per person.
1 minute per person, but if two people do it together, it will be
different. Yeah, exactly, but make the stick to the 1 minute, because one person can do 90 seconds and the other person only 30 seconds.
Yeah, definitely. So if you do it in tiers, don't do it that one just says a couple of words and the other does the conversation. George, thank you very much. Although the sound could have been better, but I personally enjoyed it. I'm very tired. I'm here from early morning. However, I will feel that I'm tired when I get home, but at the moment I'm excited and kind of wings grew. Thank you for the inspiration.
You're always very energetic, Natella. I'm always following your example. Guys, thank you very much for being a great audience. Natella knows what a valuable friend to my life she is, so anytime I'm needed, I will be there. So I hope you enjoy your evening and have a nice weekend, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And Mehmet, please let me have the link of the recording so I can download it over the weekend. Thank you.
Bye-bye.